Nyala Kadesh Nungamort, Kayan Kardak Nijabuja. We acknowledge the Noongar people as the original custodians of this land. We have gathered together this evening in the presence of Almighty God and of the whole company of heaven to offer to him through our Lord Jesus Christ our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. We reflect upon the Holy Scriptures and experience the word being illuminated by music as we hear choral settings of sacred texts and also lift our voices in praise and worship. We welcome the Reverend Steve Hilton, who, by the leading of the Holy Spirit, and after careful examination, discernment, and prayer, has been appointed as precentor of this cathedral. We pray for his ministry among us, as he now comes to be installed and to receive the Archbishop's license. We pray for ourselves, that we might all know more truly the greatness of God's love, and show forth in our lives the fruits of his grace. Wherefore, let us keep silence and remember God's presence with us now.
Lord, save me. Here beginneth the ninth verse of the third chapter of the book of Ecclesiastes. What gain have the workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds. Yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is in God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in all their toil. I know whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor nothing taken from it. God has done this so that all should stand in awe before him. That which is already has been, that which is to be already is, and God seeks out what has gone by. Moreover, I saw under the sun that in the place of justice, wickedness was there, and in the place of righteousness, wickedness was there as well. I said in my heart, God will judge the righteous and the wicked, for he has appointed a time for every matter and for every work. I said in my heart with regard to human beings that God is testing them to show them that they are but animals. For the fate of humans and the fate of animals is the same. As one dies, so dies the other. They all have the same breath, and humans have no advantage over the animals, for all is vanity. All go to one place. All are from the dust, and all turn to dust again. Who knows whether the human spirit goes upwards and the spirit of animals goes downwards to the earth? So I saw there is nothing better than that all should enjoy their work, for it is their lot. Who can bring them to see what will be after them? Here endeth the first lesson.
Here beginneth the ninth verse of the third chapter. Here beginneth the ninth chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke. Then Jesus called the 12 together and gave them power and authority over all demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal. He said to them, take nothing for your journey, no staff, nor bag, nor bread, nor money, not even an extra tunic. Whatever house you enter, stay there and leave from there. Wherever they do not welcome you, as you are leaving that town, shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. They departed and went through the villages, bringing the good news and curing diseases everywhere. Now Herod the ruler heard about all that had taken place, and he was perplexed, because it was said by some that John had been raised from the dead, by some that Elijah had appeared, and by others that one of the ancient prophets had arisen. Herod said, John I beheaded, but who is this about whom I hear such things? And he tried to see him. On their return, the apostles told Jesus all they had done. He took them with him and withdrew privately to a city called Bethsaida. When the crowds found out about it, they followed him, and he welcomed them and spoke to them about the kingdom of God and healed those who needed to be cured. Here endeth the second lesson.
Let us now thy servant.
I believe in God, O Lord, who never failest to help and govern them whom thou dost bring up in thy steadfast fear and love, keep us, we beseech thee, under the protection of thy good providence, and make us to have a perpetual fear and love of thy holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works to proceed, give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy, defend us from all perils and dangers of this night. For the love of thy only Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Thank you. We, Kay, by divine providence, Archbishop of Perth, to our beloved in Christ, the Reverend Stephen Craig Hilton, greeting. We do by this document grant to you our license and authority to perform the office of Assistant Priest, Precentor of St. George's Cathedral from the 20th of June 2022, within our diocese and jurisdiction. We commit to you the pastoral care of the people and authorize you to preach the word of God, to administer the sacraments, to read the common prayers, and perform all other ecclesiastical duties belonging to the said office, according to the form prescribed in the Book of Common Prayer or an Australian prayer book or a prayer book for Australia, and none other, except so far as shall be ordered by lawful authority, you having first made the required oaths and declarations. Provided that this license may be revoked by us at our pleasure. Registered in the Diocesan Registry of Perth, on the date herein written by me, Angela Webb, Archbishop's Registrar, in witness whereof we have set our hand and seal this 20th day of June 2022, in the year of our consecration the 14th, and the year of our translation to this see the 5th. K. Perth, Archbishop.
Gracious God, give to your servant Steve grace to fulfill this ministry. As you have called him to your service, make him worthy of your calling. Give him wisdom and discipline to work faithfully with all his fellow servants in Christ, so that the world may come to know your glory and your love. Hear our prayer, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God for ever and ever.
Amen.
Steve, receive this charge, which is both mine and yours, and accept the care and responsibility of worship in this place. May God pour upon you abundantly and be with you in your worship and your work. May you be faithful as God who calls you is faithful. Amen. It's yours. I'm going to hold your hand just for a second.
Welcome. Very Reverend Sir, I present to you Stephen Craig Hilton to be installed as precentor of this cathedral church.
Steve, as precentor, you will bear responsibility for ordering public worship in St. George's Cathedral. You will help to maintain excellence in our common prayer. You will be diligent in study and in preaching the Word of God. And you will share with your colleagues in ministering to the needs of those who come here. You will further your training as an assistant priest of this diocese. And you will undertake supervision for your spiritual and professional needs. Will you undertake your responsibilities with diligence and enthusiasm?
With the help of God, I will.
Almighty God, by whose providence thy servant Stephen is constituted precentor of this cathedral church, I beg your pardon. I, Christopher Chataway, Dean of this cathedral church, that's why I need a precentor, you see. I, Christopher Chataway, Dean of this cathedral church of St. George in the Diocese of Perth, do install you, Stephen Craig Hilton, Clerk in Holy Orders, Justice of the Peace, Master of Theology, as precentor of this cathedral to discharge the duties attached to the said office. Take this stall, that you may set forth the glory of God by your wisdom and example, and make it your chief concern to order our common worship with beauty, joy, and reverence, and to build up the body of Christ in this church. And that you may the more effectively perform this, may the Lord endow you beautifully with the grace of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, by whose providence thy servant Stephen is constituted precentor of this cathedral church, give unto him such a measure of thy grace, that what he hath here openly promised, and whatsoever his office doth demand, he may most faithfully perform to the praise and glory of thy name and the increase of thy church, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honour and glory, world without end. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you, that in all your works begun, continued, and ended in him, you may give him praise and proclaim his glory. Amen.
O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favourably on thy whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery, and by the tranquil operation of thy perpetual providence, carry out the work of our salvation. Let the whole world feel and see that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and all things are returning to perfection through him from whom they took their origin, even Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is governed and sanctified, hear the prayer which we offer for all thy faithful people, that in our several vocations and ministries we may serve thee in holiness and truth, to the honour and glory of thy holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord God of hosts, who didst so kindle the flame of love in the heart of thy servant St. George, patron of this cathedral church, that he bore witness to the risen Lord by his life and by his death, give unto us that same faith and power of love, that we who rejoice in his triumphs may come to share with him the fullness of the resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. Amen.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Before I begin, may I welcome those who are here this evening for the installation of our new precentor, the Reverend Steve Hilton. I want to welcome particularly Steve's family and friends, especially Marco, who have joined us here in this cathedral. And I want to welcome those who are viewing this service online, and in particular, the Manchester Cathedral community, who have been much in my prayers. I wish to thank the Dean of Manchester, the very Reverend Rogers Govender, MBE, and all his staff and congregation who supported Steve as he began his ordained ministry and were gracious in supporting his response to the Holy Spirit's call to come to Perth. It has been a long journey, both in time and distance, for Steve to arrive and begin here at St. George's. So we have waited eagerly, well, I know I have, for him to start. And I know Steve's been eager to begin. The great irony is, of course, that after spending months of talking on YouTube, the day after he starts at the cathedral, I lost my voice and we were back to, not YouTube, to Zooming. We were back to speaking to one another on Zoom. And I was using sign language and text, and he was looking very frustrated. And Steve, like Mary Poppins, arrived in Perth bringing the rain with him, much needed rain. So it's been great. I hope you've been surviving the very harsh and cold weather we've been having here in Perth. Harold Kushner, in his delightful book, When All You've Ever Wanted Isn't Enough, says that when he read the book of Ecclesiastes as a 17-year-old, he loved it at first sight. He remembers how much he loved how the author attacks the orthodoxies of his time, pointing out the hypocrisy and exposing the shallowness of so much that passed for piety and wisdom in his day. I thought that Ecclesiastes was like me, an idealistic young enemy of falsehood and foolishness, a challenger of pomp and pretense. But later in life, Kushner realized how badly he had understood the author, because the author was not an adolescent, but an older man, a bitter, weary man, past the midpoint of his life. And Kushner says, I completely miss the terror, which, when I go back to read it now, is so obvious to me. This is a book by a very frightened man. This book is the story of the author's life, a person confronted with the difficult truth that everything that matters in the face of death, in the end, doesn't matter at all. Nothing will remain of his life, his efforts, his successes, or his failures. So what is the point of life? What makes life meaningful? In the chapter before tonight's passage, the author writes, Then I said to myself, What happens to the fool will happen to me also. Why then have I been so very wise? And I said to myself that this also is vanity, for there is no enduring remembrance of the wise or of fools, seeing that in days to come all will have been long forgotten. How can the wise die just like fools? So it is with a cynical voice that the author asks in our reading tonight, What gain have the workers from their toil? The implied answer is nothing. And immediately before this question are the words of that famous poem, which begins, For everything there is a season, a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, and so on. And so it's the introduction to the author's attempt to chronicle events of his life, not just to ask the question, what does life mean? But to ask it in more personal terms, what does my life mean? So when the author writes, God has made everything suitable for its time, moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into our minds, he's not saying how wonderful this is, but how futile our lives are. They cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end, he says. In other words, eat, drink, and be merry because tomorrow we die, pretty well sums up his attitude. Well, I suppose at the beginning of any ordained minister's appointment, and indeed anyone starting a new position in the church or even in secular employment, will be asking themselves questions like, Will I be any good? Is this the right place for me? Will they like me? Will I make a complete mess of things? Will I fit in? Will I make a difference? And listening to the author of Ecclesiastes, we'd get a pretty negative answer to those questions. All go to one place,
All are from the dust, and all turn to dust again. Who knows whether the human spirit goes upwards and the spirit of animals goes downwards to the earth? So I saw that there is nothing better than that all should enjoy their work, for that is their lot. Who can bring them to see what will be after them? Because what will be after them is death. In other words, if they look back when it is all over, they will be persuaded that it is all pointless. But ultimately, the author of Ecclesiastes understands that this failure to see how life can be meaningful is actually a failure of seeing. Of seeing ourselves too much by human standards. We value each other for our usefulness, says Harold Kushner. But God values us far more than that. God gives us a hope in a way that no human can, by placing value on even the smallest gesture of generosity, kindness, and forgiveness. And Rabbi Kushner knew this for himself. He said, God redeems us from the sense of failure and the fear of failure because he sees us as no human eyes can see us. Some religions teach that God sees us so clearly that he knows all our shameful thoughts and nasty secrets. I prefer to believe that God sees us so clearly that he knows better than anyone else our wounds and sorrows, the cares on our hearts from having wanted to do more and do better and being told by the world that we never would. Well, I think there's something similar in our second reading tonight, where Jesus tries to teach his disciples not to focus on the things we normally think will make us happy and secure, because, just as the author of Ecclesiastes found out, how much difference your life makes is not something that ultimately matters. What matters is that we learn how to share our lives with others, making them and their world different, rather than trying to hoard life for ourselves. And as Luke tells the story, the disciples are sent on their tasks with no honor, no status, no wealth, not even the security of food. And Luke tells this story right next to telling us about Herod sitting in his palace with wealth and honor, power and status all around him. It's Luke's clever way of asking us, who is the most secure? Herod, wondering if John was still in the grave where he had put him? Or the disciples, full of hope and purpose? Herod was perplexed because it was said by some that John had been raised from the dead. If your enemies rise from the dead, you won't hold the crown for much longer. Herod lives his life constantly worried about who will knock him off his throne next. So in this not so subtle way, Luke invites us to follow the one who has nowhere to lay his head, no place to call home. And in this, we find our meaning. Steve, it is my hope for you and my prayer that like Ecclesiastes, like the disciples whom Jesus sent, you continue to have a sense of purpose and hope that only God can give. That you know that you are sent by God not to be the greatest precentor in the world or some kind of super priest, but to be who you are, and so to be the best you can be, secure in knowing that in God you matter. My hope for you and my prayer for you is that it not be the privilege of being sent that motivates you, although it is a great honor to be sent by God. But that you are motivated to share the very life of Jesus himself in word and sacrament, in loving service, sharing the story of God's hope for the world, and by sharing yourself in this way, you might make the lives of others that little bit better. May this be your joy and your privilege, as it is our joy and privilege to do likewise in Christ our Lord. Amen.
It's my great pleasure this evening to welcome Steve on behalf of the Cathedral Chapter and also the Cathedral Congregation. It's really great to see some of Steve's family here. And I have to tell you that when Steve was ordained as a deacon in Manchester Cathedral, I was there and got such a sense of the support and the friendship and everything that surrounded Steve. And I have a sense that we have someone in our midst who is personable, who has energy, who has faithfulness to in this role. So, Steve, I welcome you, and I look forward to our congregation not only growing but deepening with your presence amongst us. So, welcome and. Thank you for choosing us. We were so thrilled when we finally chose you. Thank you.
Your Grace, Archbishop Kay, the Very Reverend Dean Chris Chataway, members of the clergy and distinguished guests, and lay members of the Anglican Diocese of Perth, please allow me, on behalf of the Diocese and clergy and Perth Deanery, to welcome our new Cathedral Precentor, Father Steve Hilton. Steve, welcome to this diocese. It is a beautiful diocese with beautiful people, and welcome your beautiful self. Thank you.
On behalf of the Friends of St. George's Cathedral Association, welcome. Welcome, Steve, to you and your family, both to Perth and to this cathedral. The Friends Association exists to bind together those people that love this cathedral and love to serve it and love to worship here. The Friends are here to foster community and friendship within the cathedral, and to extend our influence outside the cathedral into the community, into the diocese, and into the world. Steve, we are invested in your success. We will stand with you, beside you, supporting you, and we pray that your ministry will be anointed and that God will prosper the work of your hands. Amen.
The Dean has warned me I only have a few minutes to reply to the gracious words of welcome we've just heard. But as I started writing earlier this week, the list of those I wish to thank seemed to grow longer and longer and longer. And so, Your Grace, Mr. Dean, Chapter, I should waste no further time by simply beginning and saying Yanga in the Noongar language, or thank you to you all. It is my firm hope that you have now piloted the HMAS Precentor into calm waters, and that your confidence and hope in the ship's ability and potential are by God's grace made true and made real. Yanga, thank you also to the clergy and staff teams, both at Church House and at the Cathedral, for their significant work preparing for our arrival. My particular sincere and heartfelt thanks go to the Dean, Mother Sarah, Bernie, Joe, the whole team here who have been gritting their teeth and answering my myriad questions. Much of what goes on in these grand and beautiful places is in the hiddenness and the detail and in the background, but it remains the Lord's work. Yanga, thank you to all those who have been involved in this evening's service, those who have welcomed me formally, our amazing musicians under Dr. Nolan, our servers, vergers, all who have come in support, not least those joining us on YouTube, new clergy and lay colleagues from across our Dawson family, members of my own family, friends who have made Marco and I so very welcome in these early days. The first thing I did last Tuesday was to try and find out what readings the lectionary had gifted us for this evening's service, So perhaps, like the Dean, I have to admit to having a chuckle when I saw our passage from Ecclesiastes on page 6. So I saw that there is nothing better than that all should enjoy their work, for that is their lot. My sisters and brothers, there is much work to do, of that I am certain. But earlier in the passage, I think we have verses that I hope will remain at the core of my priestly ministry now among you. I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in their toil. And so as we toil together in this cathedral church and across our city and diocese, let us be people of joy. Let we who claim the name of Jesus Christ reflect his joy, compassion, and mercy. Beyond our own positions, parties, and predilections, beyond our deep desires to be right and to be on the right side of things, beyond our natural fears and hopes about what the future may hold, let us first stand together in humility and let us be people of joy. Because when the crowds found out about Jesus, they followed him and he welcomed them. And he spoke to them about the kingdom of God and he healed those who needed to be cured. My dear friends, there is much work to do. Let the joy amidst the toil get underway. In God's mighty and joyful name, we pray. Amen.
So we come to this time of blessing. I want to say, Steve, I'm so glad that you and Marco are with us, and I look forward to being alongside you in ministry. Go forth into the world in peace and be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Give to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Give honour to all. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.